Fox Sports Net.
Winston Cup cars practicing for the Daytona 500. Also, our first look at Busch cars out on the track. A little bit of a morning fog delaying things just a bit as we continue our coverage up to the Daytona 500. You can now count on one hand the days until the big race. On the other hand, just a couple of days left until the twin 125s, when starting positions for the 500 will be set up. Get a look at Victory Lane. High up, Chris Myers are just above of that area you saw. And another day of Winston Cup practice for you on Fox Sports Net. Yesterday, some of the racing teams that fought the law found out that the law won. NASCAR finding a record 18 crew chiefs for rule violations. They dropped the hammer on one of them in particular. Also, a new dynamic concerning aerodynamics. Some of the Ford drivers are not happy about that. For more on that and some of the other stories, let's head down to the garage area and the pits with Steve Burns.
Well, Chris, you're exactly right. Hardest hit was Jerry Nadeau's crew chief, Tony Furr, fined nearly $14,000. He'll be suspended for 4 weeks, beginning in Rockingham. Also hit hard, Kevin Cram, the crew chief for rookie Jason Leffler. Another four-week suspension, beginning in Rockingham at $10,000. Now, the inspection room was the room of doom, and Dr. Dick Berger called this the pile of denial. Maybe now we can call all these confiscated parts trash for cash, Matt Yocum.
Steve, the long-term ramifications by the two suspensions will be felt the hardest by the 0-1 team. The most important factors for a rookie driver and young crew chief is seat time and a chance to work on communication. Now, if Leffler does make the 500, he will have only one race to work with Kevin Cram before team manager Andy Graves steps in for a four-race stretch. After this weekend, Cram won't be seen at a racetrack until Bristol. Jeannie?
From rule breakers to rule changes, the one and only second-round qualifying run for the 2001 season actually took place on Monday. Brett Bodine had the fastest car out there. There's a little historical note for you. How about another note? He did indeed have a different qualifying engine in there. This team's goal was to finish top 20. 21st, pretty close. It gives him a nice cushion for the 125. They're pretty much assured a shot in the field in the Daytona 500. And as Brett told me earlier, hey, we can have some nice relaxing suppers this week. Mike?
Fog on the racetrack. We have Busch Series practice for a while, and the Winston Cup cars will be out. You'll only see one Busch car at a time because, like Winston Cup last Friday, they're trying to get their qualifying, single car qualifying package dialed in. Let's go down right outside Victory Lane where that cutaway car sits, and next to it, Jeff Hammond.
Thanks, Mike. Today, stiff springs or soft springs with bump rubbers. A lot of the teams are also going to be working on shock absorbers. These little pistons right here, they have a lot to do with how a car works around this racetrack. And trying to find the ideal balance between chassis and aero is the key to winning here at Daytona. And for a lot of these teams, this practice will be real important when it comes to getting that done. Back to you, Chris.
All right, thanks, Jeff. Loves being around those cars. We're going to send his hair through the wind tunnel a little later. And after talking to some of the drivers this morning and the crew chiefs, one thing to look for today, the drivers drafting with possible partners if for the 125 and then also, obviously, the Daytona 500. Let's go upstairs to Darrell Waltrip, Larry McReynolds, and Mike Joy for what else we could expect today. Mike?
Well, you're right, Chris. We're going to see two very different practice sessions. You saw the car of Busch champion Jeff Green there in the garage after his one-lap run. The Busch Series, one car at a time. The Winston Cup drivers, though, all that qualifying package is out of the cars. The two rounds of qualifying are over. They're getting ready for Thursday's 125-mile qualifying races that you'll see live for the first time right here on Fox Sports Net. So, Larry, what's the game plan today for our car?
Well, you look at Brett Bodine. He went from 29th fastest, which is a little borderline when you're talking about speeds,
to 21st. Now that's, for the most part, that's probably pretty safe should he have problems in the 125. But yeah, qualifying is over. We got 2 days to get ready for the 125s. What do these guys do? They go out there and still try to make those cars drive good. Try to handle, because I bet the two winners we interview on Thursday, when you interview them, they'll say, my car drove good. But biggest curve, conditions are not optimum out there. Is the motor guy tuning these things? But DW, they probably still got the practice motors in there. They'll put them real beef sticks, them qualifiers, back in there tomorrow.
Yeah, probably so. But, you know, if I'm a driver and I'm looking at my qualifying speed and I'm saying, okay, I didn't qualify very well. My speed's pretty slow. I'm 40th in car owner points. I'm not in real good shape for getting one of those provisionals. Who do I have to beat? I'm in the second race. What guys in this race can I beat? How am I going to beat the guys to get in the top 15? And you look at who's up there and where they are in points, how they qualified, and you're going to go out and hunt those guys down. You're going to run with some of them because you want to see if you're good enough to beat them or not. That's a real confidence builder if you know you've got to finish in the top 15. So some of these guys up at the front, yeah, they're going to be having a great time. They're in the show. They don't have to worry. The guys at the back, they're fighting for their lives, just like always, and that's what makes these 125s so emotional. Some guys are having a good time during the show. Other guys are fighting for their lives.
And we'll review later who is definitely going to be in the Daytona 500 as of right now. And those are the 10 fastest speeds and the top six in owner points. They're all set, as Darrell said. Here's how that first race will line up with Dale Jarrett's Ford outside Bill Elliott's Dodge on the front row. And everyone in these first five rows is pretty well set to get in the show.
Yeah, I've always used 25 as a magic number. The 25th fastest speed's normally safe, and 25th in owner points from the 2,000 points is normally pretty safe.
There's Jerry Nadeau at the tail end. They elected not to post a speed. Excuse me, they did post a speed, 178.2 in second round qualifying. He'll have to come from the back after being disqualified from the outside pole.
Compared to his qualifying speed, that's no speed. I mean,
no.
He went from a 49, what was it, oh something, to a 51, almost 2 seconds.
He went penthouse to outhouse.
He did, buddy.
Here's a look at race two. Stacy Coppa's Dodge, Tony Stewart's Pontiac will lead them off.
The Roush cars, all four of them in the same race and actually starting within about four rows of each other.
Well, that's good news, wouldn't you think? I mean, you got teammates, you work together. Of course, all those guys other than Kurt Busch are pretty well assured. Mark and Jeff are both way up in the points, obviously, so they're going to get in the show. But maybe they can help Kurt Busch get in the show.
Thursday, you'll see the 125s live on Fox Sports Net. First time it's ever been live. We'll have more practice coverage for you tomorrow, and we're going to be here for a while today with Busch and Winston Cup practice on Fox Sports Net.
Welcome back on Fox Sports Net as the countdown to the Daytona 500 continues, which you'll see on Fox. Can you believe we're only 5 days away? The fog lifting here. Things are clearing up, too, for a lot of the drivers and the crew chiefs as they get ready. And we'll get to that Winston Cup practice delayed just a little bit because of a morning fog. We'll have that for you with Mike Joy, Darrell Waltrip, and Larry McReynolds. Let's welcome back into the studio up from his engine and his car, which is parked down below us here at Victory Lane.
I just can't get away from working on it.
That's right.
You
in the headset. You want to go. Jeff, let's talk about, you know, we have the news and the update on Nadeau, the fine suspension for his crew chief. Yeah. First of all, let me ask you, is that an appropriate penalty? Was it harsh enough?
Chris, you never know if that's going to do what NASCAR wants it to do. And the problem you run into is a situation of they're trying to make everybody understand that don't do it again. If you get caught, it's going to get worse, and it's not going to be any better for the next guy that does it. So it's got to be a deterrent. It's got to be strong enough to get the message across, and I'm not too sure they've got it there yet.
Well, help us out on the edge here in the spoiler. On what is it worth that kind of a risk when you look at the penalty here?
I don't think so. I don't think you can ever totally justify what's going on because it's a situation of, hey, look what happened to him. He's now, you know, kind of like disgraced himself, his sponsor, his owner. So I don't think it's worth it. But the reason why he did it is real simple. He felt like his car wasn't fast enough, so therefore he had to make a change. He had to do something, and I just don't think it was the right thing to do. I mean, you still got a chance in the 125s. It wasn't like if he didn't do something, it would make a difference right this minute. So I think I'd have to really think real hard and long about whether I'd go that far.
All right, we welcome in Ken Squire. And Ken, right now we're getting our first look at the Busch cars as they have a big race on Saturday. And what should we expect as we get ready for that event?
Well, you're going to see some great competition. This race historically over, in fact, in the last several years, has been the race of speed weeks, as far as I'm concerned. Now, this year, with what we've seen in the Budweiser Shootout, that Daytona 500 is going to be exceptional. But you can't disregard this race. There's a lot of Winston Cup stars in here. I was talking to Michael Waltrip this morning. He's fired up about running this 300-miler. And Larry Foyt's got the number 14 out there right now, getting that cranked in. It's fun to see another Foyt back in this competition.
And the defending champ, Matt Kenseth, 43 cars to start in that as well. As you get a look at some of the Busch cars on the track right now. Again, Winston Cup practice will be going in about an hour from now. And Jeff Hammond, let me come back to you for a moment as we get ready for the Twin 125s. Mike Choi pointed out it'll be the first time ever televised live as Fox Sports Net will have that for you. Noon Eastern on Thursday, both races. If you're a crew chief, do you want to be in that first race or the second race, or does it really matter?
Well, I think it does matter. I think it makes a big difference as far as if you're trying to plan strategy. I always like being in the second race because, again, if you're one of the guys that's back here toward the back, you get an opportunity to say, well, what do I have to do? If the first race goes off without a hitch, you almost know when you're sitting there looking down the sheet, what have you got to do? Who have you got to beat? Will the points get you in? Will your time get you in? So it gives you an opportunity to plan a lot more strategy, but it also means you got to sit there and be willing to sit on that stove, as Darrell likes to say, and sweat a little bit.
All right, we look forward to that race and the Busch event on Saturday, which you'll see on Fox. Let's head it back upstairs. Mike Joy.
Thanks, Chris. Mechanicsville, Virginia's Kevin Grubb is the fastest driver in Busch Series practice so far. 32 drivers have made laps and gone on the clock, trying to get themselves set up for qualifying for Saturday's race. Here's the speed chart so far. Young guns, Bobby Hamilton Jr., there's Scott Wimmer, Lyndon Amick, Jason Keller, who is teammate to champion Jeff Green, Bobby Hamilton, there's Green, Elton Sawyer, Todd Bodine, Blaze Alexander have the 10 fastest practice speeds so far in this abbreviated session. First time the Busch cars have been on the track.
Well, you look at Kevin Grubb there, 49.05. That's all over the top of the same speed that Bill Elliott run at a 49.02. So right now, speeds are pretty comparable. But remember, these guys, Darrell, they hadn't thrown the whole package at it yet. They're out there practicing just like Cup. They're seeing where they're at. It comes time to qualify. They'll get faster.
Yeah, I'm sure they're out there shaking these cars down. I don't think they probably got them taped up. They probably don't have fluids. You know, they're out making some practice runs here. Although you look at Green's car, Nesquik car there, he's got the whole front end taped up, so he's probably pretty serious. His first car on the racetrack had a little problem. I don't know what it was.
But he's back out. Let's meet the fastest driver so far in the Busch Series. Here's Matt.
Mike, the 37 car, did set the early mark in practice, but this is a Pontiac for Daytona, not their typical Chevrolet. Kevin, why make the switch for Daytona and Talladega?
I'll tell you, we came to Daytona last year, and we didn't do too good. The Timberwolf Chevrolet actually didn't make a race. So we worked real hard over the winter on a speedway program on a no-restrictor plate deal. We went to Talladega, tested, went to Daytona, and went to the wind tunnel. It's the first time that Bruco's been to the wind tunnel, and we learned a lot there. And yeah, we just talked to some people and thought we might be able to get a little bit of an advantage with a Pontiac here at the speedways, and we decided to go with it. And all the other tracks, we're still going to run the Chevrolets, and you know, Chevrolets are the Monte Carlo is a good cars everywhere, and we just thought we might get a little bit of advantage here, so we're gonna run them here in Talladega.
At least six teams have made the switch to the Grand Prix, but four will switch back to Chevrolet once they leave Daytona. Now let's go to Steve Burns, who's with another team that made a switch.
And that's the 10 car of Jeff Green. You're exactly right. They changed manufacturers in the offseason. Hey, DW, you ask Buddy, we'll find out. The 10 car went out early and developed a little bit of a miss. So Jeff Green, rather than cause any damage to the motor, shut it down. I walked to the crew chief, Harold Holly. Jeff Green's pulling in right now, and said, Harold, what's wrong? He said, well, to me, it's just kind of a bed bug. We want to make sure there's no serious problems under the hood. So Jeff Green, a little bit of a problem early on, but Harold Holly thinks everything's okay.
Well, that's what practice is for.
Yeah, I knew he went out, and I knew we'd have one of our best guys down there to find out exactly what happened. They sent him out kind of as a rabbit to check the racetrack, and then he came right back in. So thank you very much there, Mr. Burns. Nice job.
Rear end from Hank Parker Jr.'s car. That's the pumpkin, or third member, or center section, or whatever you'd like to call it.
That's a 9-inch Ford gear.
And the reason everyone runs the 9-inch Ford rear end, whether you're driving a Chevy, a Pontiac, Dodge, or whatever, is because you can take that center section out and change gears quickly. If you were running a General Motors type rear end, you'd have to take full rear end, axles, brakes, everything out to make a change. Expensive to stock a lot of those parts. Very time consuming to change.
And that's one thing that's common in all makes is this type of rear end, whether you're a Ford, whether you're a Pontiac, Chevrolet, or a Dodge, you all run the same 9-inch Ford ring gear and pinion.
More than likely, that's an interesting thing right there, Larry. That gear is actually dry sunk. And that's it. I don't even want to go there because it takes too long, but that gear's, the grease is being circulated out of that gear just like it is out of the engine. And I haven't seen that on many cars, but that's a speed item. Remember we talked about earlier in the week when we were watching the Winston Cup cars, drag is drag. You can get it out of the gears, or you can get it out of the car, out of the motor, wherever. It's always a little more speed.
Now you saw a number right there, 291. So that means every to get the rear wheel to turn once, that drive shaft has to turn 2.91 times.
And they may be taking out a 2.91, and they could even just be going up to like a 2.94, or they could be going to a 300. You never know, because such minor little changes here can make a huge difference in how the car runs. And a lot of that's based on, don't forget the weather, how the wind's blowing, what the humidity's like, where the engine produces its most power. Lots of things are considered when you start changing rear gear.
And, you know, just talking about these numbers, 291, 300, 307, and that's about the different ratios. Where those numbers come from is you divide the number of teeth on the pinion into the number of teeth on the ring gear. And what you got to remember, and it's backwards, and it took me a while to remember this, is a 291 is a lower number than a 300, but it's a higher gear ratio. The lower the number, the higher the ratio, and that's something that guys will really fine-tune here, because there's several factors that consider what gear you run. And Daryl, one of the big factors is wind. If you get more wind, more of a headwind down that back stretch, you've got to put a lower gear because it's pushing against you harder.
Now, yeah. If you've decided your optimum RPM is 6,600 and you're pulling a 291 gear, and in those conditions, as Larry said, you may not be able to get up to 6,600 RPM. The engine may only pull 6,300, and that's when you go to a lower gear so you can get up to that optimum RPM range.
Exactly, because we talk about engine people do peak power, and you try to get the engine to perform at peak power. That way you get the most out of the engine, and that's all up to the engine tuner and the engine builder. And timing, you see the timing light here? He's getting ready to check the timing on that engine. They will keep the timing down low, somewhere around maybe 28 to 30 degrees to practice. But when they get ready to go qualify, they put the engine on what they call kill. And when they put it on kill, they put it up on 32 to 34 degrees of timing and make that engine run that much better.
Look at that. They've got the valve cover sponsored. They've got the hat over the carburetor sponsored. They got logos and stickers everywhere.
Well, that's typical Earnhardt. He's got his name all over everything.
Yeah. Now these motors, they are the same as a Winston Cup motor, but one difference here at Daytona is they run a 29/32nd restrictor plate under the carburetor. That's a 32nd of an inch smaller than the 15/16ths that Winston Cup runs, and that equates out to about 20 or 25 horsepower.
I'm burning my calculator up. I got 291s and 394s and 300. Now you give me these 15/16ths and 32nds, I'm about to go nuts here.
I'm just wondering where I can get a set of those signature valve covers.
I can get them for you, but they're going to cost you a little bit.
I was afraid of that. We'll be right back. Busch Series practice out on Daytona International Speedway. Winston Cup practice coming up in a little while here on Fox Sports Net.
Like a lot of people, we have some credit card debt.
Welcome back to Daytona on Fox Sports Net, where Saturday on Fox, you'll see the Napa 300 for these Busch Series cars. And then later that day on FX, the big rush hour. The Daytona 500, 43rd annual. Coverage begins 11:30 a.m. this Sunday on Fox. Be there or be left out.
Mike, I checked on those valve covers.
Thank you.
A generic set, about $100.
Yep.
If you want the Earnhardt signature, $3,000.
But you know what? If you'll give me them set of valve covers, I'll go get them just to autograph them. Won't cost you near that.
But it will, Larry. No, you said near that. But it will cost you.
Yeah, well, of course. Nothing's free up in this movie.
Hey, owner, driver, you know, we got to make it where we can, Pard.
That's it. We'll get there. There is Jeff Green. He's the series champion and the youngest of three racing brothers. When you're the youngest of three brothers, sometimes it's hard to make your mark. Jeff found he could make his behind the wheel.
I started racing go-karts at eight, so once we got rolling into go-karts, you know, that kind of took us to where we are right. Has taken us to where we are right now. Growing up, we raced anything we could race. When it come a good rain, we would race popsicle sticks down the gutter. So anytime, you know, we could be competitive with each other, our neighbors and my two brothers, I think that's what got the fire lit, and it's still burning. No doubt about that.
I tell you, Mike, makes me know I'm in the right place, because I raced against their dad, David. I raced against their uncle, Clyde, and they were little bitty boys wearing diapers when I was racing. So time flies when you're having fun, and I must have been having an awful lot of fun.
I guess.
Time sure did go by fast.
There's the oldest brother, David Green, who is the 94 Busch Series champion, and Mark Green also having a good run in this series.
Is it the
water in Owensboro, Kentucky?
Well, I was just going to tell you.
Two Waltrips, a Mayfield, three Green brothers, and they've all made it big down.
And there's a bunch of mechanics down there that are all from Owensboro. There's about 25, 30 guys all total in that garage area today that are from Owensboro, Kentucky. We went up there and we did a little piece, and that's going to show up later on in the week about Owensboro, and we tried to answer the question. Now, I don't know. At the end of the day, I'm not so sure we didn't confuse the issue even worse than it was, but we tried to answer the question.
You'll see that on our Dodge pre-race for the Daytona 500.
Right.
I got a question, though, D.W.
Yeah.
Did you and Michael ever race popsicle sticks down the rain gutter?
No, we couldn't afford popsicles.
Sell a couple more sets of those valve covers. It won't be a problem.
Yeah,
here's the speed chart, and you see no changes among the top four, but Joe Bessie, the driver from Scarborough, Maine, who last year participated as a car owner for Jeff Bodine in Winston Cup, has taken all of the assets of his team. They lost their major sponsor due to corporate consolidation. And so Bessie has taken the cars and the parts and decided to try it himself. He has a sponsor for this race and an uncertain future, but there he is, fifth on the speed chart.
Every sponsor ever lost was because of corporate consolidation. They wanted my money to put back in their corporation.
Let's get out of the Winston Cup garage in Genie's, Alaska.
Yeah, just warming up here, but I'll tell you what, life is good for the number eight car. They had the fastest practice time on Monday. They put in their long run on Monday, so they feel pretty comfortable. They could go 50 laps without stopping. Today, they're just going to work on some different shock combinations. Not a whole lot of drafting plan, because honestly, Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s car is so fast, the others will be using him instead. Mike?
Thanks, Genie. Hard at work.
That's Tony Eury Jr. there. His dad works on that car, and his dad, Tony Sr., was Dale Earnhardt's crew chief on his Busch car. So the family affair continues.
It's going to be an abbreviated practice session for Winston Cup this afternoon due to the late start, to the fog, and a bit of haze.
Oh, yeah, just tighten her on down. I love pressure. Take away some of my precious practice time.
Matt Kenseth is on the speedway. He's the Winston Cup Rookie of the Year, but he continues to run a few Busch Series races for the Reiser family. Robbie Reiser owns this team. First came to Daytona as the driver, realized that if they were going to run up front, he needed a different driver, and he hired Matt Kenseth. Matt came down and won in the Busch Series, and then when Matt went to Winston Cup for Jack Roush, he took Reiser with him as his Cup crew chief.
Yeah, I raced with Robbie a lot up in the ASA Series, and a good racer and a good car builder, obviously. This car has won a number of races with Matt at the wheel and contended strongly for the championship against Dale Earnhardt Jr.
The first time these two guys come to Daytona to run the Busch race, about, I think, 3 years ago, they were sponsorless. They got a sponsor before the race. They needed to paint the car, though. Robbie got NASCAR's approval to take the car to a body shop. They said, before hours to paint this car. And you got to have it back. They went out and had it painted, put the sponsor on the car, had a top five finish. The sponsor said, well, maybe that was pretty cool. We'll try one more race. They went to Rockingham the next week and won the race. They had a sponsor for the rest of the year then.
Yeah. Cinderella story. That's how it works. Now Matt Kenseth, as Winston Cup Rookie of the Year, gets to come back and run a few Busch races. He talks about running the Busch car.
There's a few reasons I enjoy racing the Busch Series. It's a lot of fun. It's a little less stressful than Winston Cup. The guys I race for are the guys that got me into NASCAR to start with for the Reiser family, so it's important for me to help keep their business rolling over there. And I also learn from it. I get twice the experience at the track, so we run on the same tires. And now with the rules changing in the Busch Series, we're going to run with almost the same horsepower. So some of the things that we learn over there, I can translate to our Winston Cup car.
Matt got married this fall. Katie, also from Wisconsin, his bride, and Robbie Reiser was in the wedding. And after the wedding, Reiser got all over the minister because in the service, the minister said, now, Matt, this is the most important ring you will ever wear. And Robbie got all over the minister. He says, no, it's not. He says, there's that Winston Cup championship ring that he's got to win. He says, I want you to tell him what you said was wrong.
Well, I don't have to tell you that he's driving my favorite number. So, I had that number in Winston Cup for a long, long time. Had it on my Busch car for a long, long time. And I'm pretty proud of the fact that that young man is carrying it and carrying on the tradition very, very well.
We may have mentioned it, but he is the defending champion of this race coming in on Saturday.
We didn't, but thank you, because that's quite true. The Napa 300 you will see live on Fox this Saturday. Back on track is Kevin Grubb, who has the fastest practice speed thus far. 49.051 seconds, 183.48 miles an hour. That's a mean-looking nose on that Pontiac. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Daytona International Speedway. 46 Busch Series cars are signed in for this race. Most of them have a chance to get out on the track and run a few practice laps. There is the defending series champion, Jeff Green. New brand this year for Green. Switching over, same sponsoring paint scheme. And right now at 181.66 miles per hour, he is 14th fastest.
And Steve Burns talked about that a little bit in the beginning. You know, him and teammate Jason Keller, first and second in the points from 2000, dominated the whole series, and they made a brand change. And I talked to Greg Polix over the winter, the owner of these two teams, and I said, Greg, why would you do that? He said, two things figured in. And this is pretty good philosophy, or straight different philosophy, Darrell. He said, I was so afraid that because of the season we had, we would get stagnant. We would get lazy because we thought we had them where we wanted them. But he said, I set my crew chiefs, I set my drivers, I set my engine guys down. I laid it all out on the table. And a lot of times when you make a manufacturer change, yeah, the dollars that a manufacturer gives you is important, but technical expert advice and wind tunnel time you could get, you can't put a price on that.
You know what I'd have said? I'd have given them one reason, Mark Martin.
Yes.
If he can do it and win the races he won, then boys, look what we
can do. There's something there.
And he's not going to be in the series next year.
That's right.
So all those things that you mentioned are certainly car owners' points of view. But if I was a competitor, crew chief or driver, I'd say, yeah, you know, look how Mark runs and Jeff Burton runs, and this is a good move for us.
Well, in this series, the price of poker has gone up. Steve Burns has more.
Boy, it certainly has, Mike. And an issue we should talk about briefly, the compression ratio has changed on these motors. Well, what does that mean? It means it's gotten more expensive for the car owners. They can change parts around, but it's a trickle-down effect. You know, it goes all the way through the drivetrain. They even have to buy more expensive brakes. They're going faster. They got to get these things slowed down.
Brembos and Alcons and APs, some of these new brake systems that have come in, What's a set of brakes cost, Daryl?
Gosh, I don't know, about $6,000.
All I know is Richard used to come in and complain about how much money we were spending on brakes. You'd think, well, you know, you need to spend money on things to make you go fast, make you run fast, and brakes couldn't be part of that, but brakes is very important a lot of racetracks we go to.
But you know what? As a driver, let me tell you, we come down here with these are racing rotors here. They're real thick. And what we come down here to qualify with are rotors that's about as thick as that line I drew on the screen. That's for qualifying. Get that mass down, the weight down, the unsprung weight down. And what we always try to do is race those things. Well, if anything happens out on the racetrack, you got the little bit thin rotors on there, the car won't stop. The other thing is when you come down pit road, even though you're going 55 miles an hour, you don't have near the brake you need to get the cars wowed up. So you qualify with one set of brakes, $6,000. Then you go get you another set of brakes, $6,000, and put those on the race with. That's one of those items that I was talking about that runs the cost of qualifying up at Daytona and Talladega.
And you got to have a set of those brakes for every car you got. You got to have spares, and it just goes on and on and on. You know, one thing I think we need to talk about is, you know, we've talked about the engine relationship between Winston Cup and Busch cars. We need to talk just a little bit about the cars themselves. Now, you've got several differences in a Busch car and a Winston Cup car. One difference is the weight. And the Winston Cup cars weigh 3,400 pounds. The Busch cars are 100 pounds lighter at 3,300 pounds. One other difference is the wheelbase difference. The distance between that on a Winston Cup car, that distance is 110 inches. On a Busch car, it's 105 inches. But looking at Daytona, if you notice, there's no roof fin on top of that car like on the Winston Cup cars. And on the rear spoiler, there is not that lip that goes on top of that like Winston Cup cars. The Winston Cup cars here have to run 70 degrees. Busch cars can run 55 degrees. And to me, the final item there is we talk about springs. There's no rule on a Winston Cup front spring here at Daytona, but they make these guys run a minimum of 1,500-pound front springs. These Cup cars be qualifying with 300 or 400-pound springs, and on the rear springs, Cup cars can't run less than 350. Busch cars can't run less than 415. So the bottom line is the Busch cars have a lot stiffer spring package in it.
Yep.
There you see the roof fin. The Busch car, this is the roof fin. The Busch car does not have that. They decided not to go with the aero package.
Well, could we have a situation where the Busch cars qualify faster than the Cup cars?
Oh, they're going to, I think they'll definitely be faster.
You know, they got a smaller plate, they got stiffer springs, but they don't have that aero package. That fin and that more degrees of spore, that puts a lot of drag in the car, how it goes down the straightaway. So I think it's going to equate to probably a little faster speed.
Yeah, just ask Jerry Nadeau about that spoiler. I doubt that's pretty important.
We will have the Napa 300 for you live on Fox this Saturday, and of course the Daytona 500 live on Sunday. More gear changes going on down there in the garage area. Let's shift gears and get down to our victory lane set and Chris Myers.
Welcome inside our studio just above Victory Lane. We welcome in a gentleman who has had cars running in the Busch Series. Of course, he's seen every Daytona 500 with the 90 car, Hut Strickland, for this year's Daytona 500, Junie Dunleavy. It's a pleasure to have you with us in all the years that you've seen a lot of racing here. We'll get to the Busch Series in a moment, but I got to ask you about the magnitude of the Daytona 500. You've seen it. You were here for the first one, had a car in your first car in 1960. Why do you think it has become the great American race that it has become?
Well, it's a very good sport, and I think when I got into racing, I was really a fan more than I was a racer, because I enjoyed racing. I was raised with the sprint cars, and I don't know, I've just always enjoyed watching the competition that you had there. So when I come down here, I still come down as a fan, and I really enjoy being here, and from the beach days all the way up through right now.
Yeah, the old road race right across a few miles on the actual beach. Well, how have you kept up, Mr. Dunleavy, with the technology and the advancements in the sport?
Well, Ford has been very good to us. We've been running Fords ever since 60. And even in the modifieds, we ran the flathead Fords. But they are very good to us. They keep us abreast of what's going on, what we need. I had some of the best engine builders, even back then, from Holman and Moody to Bud Moore and on up through to Mark Smith, who we have today. So it's, I knew that I wasn't set up to come down here and really take care of everything down here. Okay. But a lot of years we did come down here and we ran very good.
All right. Hey, Mr. Dunleavy, this is DW up in the booth. How you doing today?
Darrell Waltrip has a question for you.
Hello, Darrell.
How you doing, buddy? Hey, how about the first time I ever met you down here in 1972? What were you doing then?
I was watching you standing over there wondering what had happened. We kind of qualified him pretty good, and then he had one of Holman Moody's cars, and he couldn't figure out how we were running that much faster than he was. So from then on, I tried not to ever hit that speed again, and as long as Darrell Waltrip was in it, because I didn't want to see him upset.
How many times did y'all win that race?
Three times in a row with Bill Dennison, 71, 72, 3, right. And 4.
Yeah.
And we're right proud of that, and we took him away from home and brought him down here. And Bill Dennis was a terrific driver, and if he hadn't gotten hurt in 75, he would have still been with us, I think.
And, of course, you had the win at Dover with Jody Ridley.
Right, and we were proud of that, but we were mighty happy to be running third, and we hated to see the two cars in front of us really break down but blow the engines. But we accepted it because we had been leading a lot of races down through the years itself, and we had stuff happen, so.
Ken Squire has a question for you.
Well, you've got a hard patch down here. You're going to start 19th in that second 125, and the speed on the car, that number 90 car with Hutch Strickland, is about 178. This is a tough one for you to get into, this 500.
Really, we're leaving it up to our driver, Hutch Strickland, and we feel like that he's good enough. He understands the drafting very well, so we know in a draft, when we used to have Dick Brooks down here, if you were only 10 miles an hour quicker than we were, we knew we could run with you. So I feel that way with Hutch. So.
There's one thing about you, Junior. You don't get excited now, do you?
Right. No, not really.
Always calm and cool.
Yep. One of the nicest men in racing right here. I want you to know that right there, too. He has always been a gentleman, and he would help anyone and his brother out. I don't care what the situation is. You go over to Junior Dunleavy and say, Junior, I got a problem. He says, well, let me just help you fix it.
And still has the passion for the sport. We appreciate you coming by to say hi with us.
It's a real honor and a pleasure to come by, sir.
All right. Thank you. Talking about his victories in the Napa 300. By the way, Darrell Waltrip won the race 4 times, I believe. I'm sure he'll want to talk about that when we come back. Winston Cup practice, too, just about 30 minutes away here. We'll tell you about that as you get a look at some of the practice times as we get you ready for the Napa 300 on Fox this Saturday. We'll go up. Welcome back live to Daytona. We're glad to have you with us on Fox Sports Net. Wednesday, we'll bring more practice from the Winston Cup cars as they get ready for the Daytona 500, which, of course, you'll see on Fox. 10:30 Eastern on Fox Sports Net tomorrow for more of the practice. And Thursday, a history-making event for the first time ever. The Twin 125s will be broadcast live, and you'll see that on Fox Sports Net. We'll continue with more of the Busch cars practicing for the Napa 300 and the Winston Cup cars ready to hit the track, do some drafting. So stick around.
Back to Daytona International Speedway. 5 days till the Daytona 500 on Fox. We can hardly wait as the anticipation builds and the Busch Series cars run toward their 300-mile race that you'll see this Saturday on Fox. Yesterday on Fox Sports Net, you saw tape coverage of Sunday's ARCA REMAX 200. Bad crash here as Donnie Morlock spins the 23 of Ron Cox. Gets it straightened out, but then loops it. Ben Hess sacrifices his white car to the wall, and pow! Cox pancakes the inside wall. He was treated for a fractured left elbow, contusion of the left shoulder, and a concussion, but released from the hospital. Fortunately, he's okay.
Well, those driver side impacts like that, you just can't appreciate what that feels like if you're the passenger in that car. You're right out against those door bars. When that car slaps that wall like that, the driver is so vulnerable. His shoulder, his arm, his head, his whole left side of his body is basically a part of the car.
Michael Waltrip on the speedway in his snazzy looking Busch car. He is 15th fastest.
Yeah, maybe he'll pick her up a little bit here. He was tuning on it a minute ago, and he loves to run Daytona. Turned over here last year.
There's the top 10. Kevin Grubb, Bobby Hamilton Jr. has climbed the speed chart to second place. Let's visit with him.
Bobby Hamilton Jr., Mike, very fast out of the box as this session is drawing to a close, Bobby. What are you hoping to accomplish in the second session that you did not accomplish in the first?
Just stay out of trouble. You know, pretty much everybody's unloaded right now is pretty much what they've got. I mean, we have a few tricks, and but it's going to be about the same speedway guys. You're probably going to sit on a pole. You got Nemechek and all them guys. They've only ran one lap and about as fast as anybody. So you got to keep working your tail off. And the first session is just to get your car, make sure ain't no bumps and rubs and stuff like that. But when you can unload fast, it's real easy because now I can go back to Dr. Pepper and a Winnebago and just chill for the rest of the time and just wait for the next session and everything. And my dad's quick over there. He's running the Busch race in the Diet Dr. Pepper car, and we're just happy. You know, this is everything that we worked on all winter. Got Dr. Pepper on board and all the momentum built up. And I think it was last week I was watching the Bud shootout, and I was like, I'm leaving early. I'm going down there early. And I got here a whole lot earlier than I should have, just sitting there just looking at all the stands like I'm ready to go. So we're pretty happy. We're just going to just wait and see. It's a big old waiting game now.
He looks ready to go early on, trying for his second straight pole. He won his first in the season finale at Homestead. Steve?
Well, Matt, Kevin Harvick was the 2000 Busch Series Rookie of the Year. Kevin, you came down here, shocked some people last year, ran fifth. How do you feel, different, better, or worse a year later?
Well, I mean, obviously we have a lot more race cars built coming into this season, and we have race cars to race after we get done with Daytona. But, you know, right now the main focus is trying to get through Daytona and come out with a good finish, and I think the AC Delco Monte Carlo will probably do that.
This series will run 33 events this year, 27 different tracks in 25 states. It's truly a national series. These fellas going to get a lot of exposure on what most of them hope will be a final step to a Winston Cup career.
A lot of people think Harvick could, you know, he's a candidate to move up into the Winston Cup series. And I read that he had eye surgery, that LASIK eye surgery over the winter to he didn't have an eye problem. He just wanted to be better. He wanted to make it better. And that just shows you the commitment that these young guys are willing to make to this sport.
And once again, Richard Childress, I think, has proved he has a knack for finding talent. Richard has the two Busch cars, Kevin Harvick and Mike Dillon, and they made an announcement earlier this week that they are starting in Atlanta in about a month. They're going to run Kevin Harvick in 7 Winston Cup races. Probably going to run the full season. Richard Childress should have 3 Winston Cup teams in 2002.
Another fellow with an eye for talent is Jack Roush. He took Greg Biffle off the short tracks of the Northwest, put him in his Craftsman Truck Series machine, and won the championship there. And now Biffle promoted to the Busch Series for the year 2001. Now this is the car and team that Mark Martin had such great success with. The all-time Busch Series leading race winner. Martin is retired from the Busch Series, and Biffle steps in to a slightly larger seat in the same set of cars.
Yeah, and, you know, people may or may not remember this, but Mark has struggled one place with that car through the years, and it's been at Daytona. As a matter of fact, Mark missed this race a couple of years ago. So, you know, Biffle's got his work cut out for him here. I know they're a lot better team probably today than they were when Mark first started with them, but still, that is no shoe-in that he's going to run well here.
Now, most of the crew on this car, though, comes with Biffle from the Truck Series. Randy Goss is crew chief, and a lot of the folks working on that car are familiar to Greg.
Yeah, I think that's kind of common these days. Once a driver and a crew chief, they get that communication down, they feel comfortable with each other. Driver knows what to tell the crew chief knows what to do. Larry, you can talk about that. That's just a combination you want to keep together if it's at all possible.
We saw that with Matt Kenseth. We saw it with Earnhardt Jr.
Right.
We talked about it at length at dinner last night. You take a fellow like Jimmy Makar and Bobby Labonte. Not only are they crew chief and driver, they're best friends. They spend almost all their waking hours together. It's that relationship is so important.
Yes, it is. And this is Christian Elder here. We saw him in the Goodies Dash race on Sunday. But, yeah, that chemistry, it's like a marriage. It's almost like a husband and wife. And you know, Larry McReynolds had that chemistry with Davey Allison. The win showed it. Had it with Ernie Irvin. The win showed it. With Dale Earnhardt, we're great friends, but we never had that chemistry. We had different philosophies. Again, a lot of people said, hey, these guys don't get along. We got along. We just didn't have that chemistry that I think a good crew chief driver relationship needs and has to have to win races in this Winston Cup Series.
Well, once a driver gets confidence in a crew chief, I don't care who he is, he can be a floor sweeper. You say, I want that guy to be my crew chief because he understands me, and it's not all about wrenches. It's a lot about personality and how you get the most out of somebody. I think that's what makes Joe Gibbs such a great leader, is he knows how to assemble people, personalities, and then he also knows how to get the most out of those people.
A lot of car owners have come into NASCAR and spent millions of dollars to buy the right parts and pieces. Joe Gibbs found a way to put the people together and make those parts and pieces fall together into a championship team. Here's Ashton Lewis Jr. on the Speedway. You're watching Busch Series practice. Later on our coverage today, the Cup cars. Jeannie, are down there getting ready to roll.
Yeah, countdown to the Winston Cup practice for a Tuesday. Some teams chomping at the bit, others realizing, hey, we can relax a little bit here. You know, no chance really for others to dial in because they've got everything going on, like checking on the carburetor, the aero package, the shock package, and I'm talking about Morgan Shepherd in particular. Had a chance to chat with him, and he said, you know what, we will even have the 125 engine in here because we have to race our way into this thing. Mike?
I look there at Derek Culp's number 37, Johnny Benson's number 10. As they get ready to go, I saw Bobby Hamilton's car up toward the front of the line. I don't think he was in it. He's out practicing his Busch car still. Here are the speeds so far, and there you see Hamilton ninth on the chart. His son is second. Kevin Grubb remains the fastest lap of the day. And now Jason Keller has moved up to third quickest. You're watching Busch and Winston Cup practice on Fox Sports Net.
Wrap up your race day with NASCAR Victory Lane.
Also up on the booth, Mike Choi, Larry McReynolds, and Darrell Waltrip, and we welcome in Cal Wells, PPI Motorsports. Nice to see you. Of course, the owner of the 32 car with Ricky Craven, Andy Houston, and I guess Andy's going first in the twin 125s, and then also Ricky going in the second run of that. We appreciate you being with us, and let's talk about your position in that race and what you expect from your cars.
Well, for us, the 125s is just an opportunity to feel out where, particularly with Andy, we've gotten come to grips with this aerodynamic package and how Andy's come to grips with a Winston Cup car at a plate race. He hasn't done it yet.
Andy being a rookie, of course.
Exactly.
And Ricky Craven, the decision to go with him, considering what he's been through to be your guy?
Well, I felt that I've opened up a hope chest at the foot of Rick Hendrick's bed and found an old diamond he tossed away, and I polished it all up. It looks great to me, so we're going to run it and see how it goes.
And shining it brightly this week.
Well, Cal, I was wondering, when you came into NASCAR, did you really have any idea what you're really getting into? I mean, this is a pretty tough nut to crack, and I mean, you've raced in all different kinds of forms of racing, so how do you compare it?
Well, it's the toughest thing I've ever done, and I've had a lot of exciting types and styles of racing I've been involved with, and certainly I have a personal love for every single one of them because they all have a lot to offer, but there's nothing more challenging than Winston Cup that I've ever even thought about climbing.
When you came in, did you have a goal? I mean, do you have a goal in mind? Did you say, I'm going to win a race my second year, my first year, I'm going to win my championship my third year? Do you have a plan?
I had a plan.
Had a plan. Had a plan.
You had to adjust that a little along the way, right?
Pretty radically adjusted pretty early
changing,
on.
Yeah.
But we, you know, our plan last year was to qualify for every race, and we didn't meet that goal. This year we have the same because of our position, particularly with Andy. We've got the first four races. We've got to put points on the board. So come the fifth race, we're protected if we have some sort of bad luck in any of the other qualifying rounds. So our focus is just to do as best we can to get ourselves in the show and finish every race. After that, I've got a lot of confidence in both Ricky Craven and Andy Houston that they'll continue to put points on the board every year. And we might threaten once or twice. We're pretty excited.
Good. Cal, a year ago you came down here and you qualified ninth, and it looked like it was in gear and ready to go, and then the whole thing turned to quicksand. What really happened?
Well, you know, the plate races, I mean, the real season starts next week. right now at Rockingham, right now there's so much to what you're able to put into the car, the technology into the car. Of course, we have fabulous power with Robert Yates Ford engines. And so it's a lot of work for us to qualify well here. But last year, I think the Fords had a bit of an advantage, and that we were kidding ourselves. We got a real wake-up call at Rockingham, and after that, we were in there fighting every weekend. But there was a lot of things we just didn't understand. I particularly didn't understand about the series.
Go back to Craven for a moment. A lot of people have given up on Craven. He had the third place here in 97. He got whacked a couple more times down in Texas, a couple more races, and a lot of people backed off on him. And of course, some of us New Englanders have got our back up about that because we think he's pretty good. But what made you really pick up on him and try to dust off this diamond?
Well, I think he just needed a fair shake. When we looked at what we needed in our team, bringing on a rookie driver in our 96 McDonald's car, we needed someone for him to understudy with. I needed an owed tie, better results than I produced last year. So I wanted someone with some history, but not someone that was really in the twilight of his career, and Ricky fit that bill tremendously. Being an enthusiast, a fan for several years, I did follow him in Busch, and he's an incredible dogfighting racer, and I think that maybe a few things that happened to him, maybe the way he handled a few things and some of the people he worked for just really didn't give him the fair shake that I think he deserves and hopefully will provide.
Hey, Kyle, this is Darrell Waltrip up in the booth. How you doing today?
Great, Darrell.
I'm curious, being a former car owner myself, and you have two highly visible sponsors that most people in the garage would give their eye teeth to have on the side of their car. How have you been able to keep them content? All I ever heard as a car owner was performance, performance, performance. And, of course, you know, that up and down roller coaster that you get on. How have you kept these two major league sponsors happy through the growing pains that you've experienced?
Well, sometimes you don't. I think with McDonald's, they've when they made the decision to have a huge shift in philosophy with their Cup program, they realized that it was going to be a pretty steep hill to climb, and as yet we really haven't had an opportunity to perform for them one way or the other. I think that their expectations are realistic. With Tide, certainly the challenges that we faced last year, where they had come from with such a strong incumbent, they also realized that it was going to take quite a bit of change and to get really ultimately the way they wanted to. And you know, it's interesting, there's a lot of business analogies that some of the very senior people at Tide have utilized when looking at our racing operations. Specifically, they've had some interesting stock fluctuations lately because they decided to have a new rebirth in the way that Procter & Gamble approach business, and it's the same way they look with their racing program. Fortunately, we've got great communication. I consider a lot of them at both Tide and McDonald's friends, and so far I think we're meeting expectations, and hopefully we'll continue to meet them.
Yeah, I was just really curious about that because I was, as I struggled with my team, you know, I always wondered what else could I do when the car wasn't performing well. What could I do? What could I do as a car owner to keep those people off my back while I got my program going in the right direction?
I guess you could go to McDonald's, right? Use the drive-thru, you know?
Exactly. You know, they haven't been on my back that hard, really. Obviously, we disappointed ourselves last year. And as long as Tide realized that we were very committed to the success that they wanted, coming from where they were in the points, you know, they were 32nd last year in the points, so it wasn't as if we were needing to compete in the top 10 right away. And there are some other things that we bring, the marketing side and public relations and so on and so forth, that create a lot of the image that they felt was very important to them. So, so far I haven't had a problem, and the challenge that I didn't have that you did, Darrell, is I'm not trying to drive the car as well, so that helps a little
that
bit.
That makes it a little easier. Let's get upstairs to Mike Joy. Mike?
Thanks, Chris. We're just moments away from the end of Busch Series practice. The Winston Cuppers will be out here shortly. Kevin Grubb remains the fastest of the Busch Series drivers that have been on the speedway, and Bobby Hamilton Jr. is second quickest. Now you see in these last waning moments a couple of drivers going out there getting a toe in the draft, so some of the times that we'll give you later will be wind-aided, as we've said. Let's check with Jeannie.
Well, you know, everyone has their favorite for the Daytona 500, but it is all about making the field, and no one knows that better than Derek Cope, who did that in 9. He was able to win it here. What kind of things will you be working on today?
Basically just drivability. You know, we we have to get in or get out come Thursday. So we've got to get drivability in the car for long periods of time. So right now we're trying to run a long 30, 40 lap run a day, make sure we don't wear the right front tire out, and see if we get this K&N Filters Ford in and ready for the 125s.
Have you been able to give it a real long test out there?
We ran 30 laps yesterday, and just saw a little bit of trouble in the right front as far as camber, so we make an adjustment there, a shock change. And now I'm just going to go back out and see if it drives as good as it did yesterday. We were really good on the bottom for all 30 laps. Elliott pushed us to the front of that draft, so I'm going to be okay.
A lot of drama to that finish in 90. Do you still have people coming up here today talking about it?
Yeah, a lot of people still talk about it. You know, I mean, anytime that Earnhardt wins or loses, you get a lot of talk about it. But, you know, we just got to try to get back to like DJ and win a third, or for us, win a second. It'd be good for MSN and WMHINC.com and all the guys that have helped us so far.
Thanks so much, Mike.
Cope won in a Bob Whitcomb-owned car from New Hampshire. Buddy Parrott engineered that victory. And even though Earnhardt's car faltered in the final mile of the 500, Cope was in the hunt all day, rode the victory lane.
He had a great car all day long. He was right there to take advantage of somebody else's bad luck.
Okay, a couple of notes here. Joe Bessie's time there in third gets an asterisk. He was in a tight draft with the number 74. So that time of Bessie's might not be indicative of what he can run by himself. Also the 45 car, Steve Grissom, in 11th place there. He was in a tight draft when he ran that speed. So, you know, these will go down as the official practice speeds, but some of them are running one car at a time, and some of them had a little bit of help from the draft. Busch Series practice is over. When we come back, we'll turn our attention to Winston Cup practice here on Fox Sports Net.
After an illustrious 10-year NBA career, this former Chicago Bull is still making his points.
It's Norm Van Leer and Eric Goodman on Chicago Sports Tonight, a half hour before every Bulls game on Fox Sports Net.
Oh, Becky, look.
Wow.
There's a Big Dipper, and there's Orion.
Daddy?
Uh-huh.
Who turns off the stars at night?
Nobody. They're on all night.
So how can we never see them from home?
Discover the world through a new set of eyes. Go RVing. Visit an RV dealer or call for a free video.
What's the matter, Ronnie? Masculine itching?
How'd you know?
When I experience masculine itching, I reach for Extra Strength Itch Stopper Plus.
How does it work?
When your body heats up, Ronnie, enzymes mixed with bacteria can cause unsightly discomfort.
Boy, howdy.
But with just two fingers of the patented oily balm applied to the affected area, you can be swinging.
Get TiVo and skip the stuff you don't want to see. Learn more at TiVo.com.
Are you ready to ask your doctor about Viagra? Get ready.
All right.
Ask your doctor if a free sample of Viagra is right for you.
Well, I'm ready for you. I hope you're ready for me.
This is a bucket of water. And this is Goodyear's new and improved AquaTread 3.
At highway speeds in a downpour, a set of AquaTread 3 tires pumps away over 6 gallons of water per second. That's over 360 gallons per mile. With its 80,000-mile tread life limited warranty, that's a lot of water. Think about it next time it's pouring buckets. New AquaTread 3.
Serious freedom.
Only from Goodyear.
Goodyear, Goodyear.
The nation's outstanding race drivers, behind the wheels of a dozen different makes of new cars, will be after a rich $1,200 purse.
A bolt of fear went through him as they thundered through the sky, for he saw the riders coming hard, and he heard their mournful cry.
stock car drivers ready to roll out on the track here in Daytona as their Whiskey Cup practicing continues. We're going to show it to you in just a moment. We get you ready for the Daytona 500 on Fox. You're watching Fox Racing here on Fox Sports Net. You're going to look into some of the cars that are ready to go here on the track. And we're back at the studio. I wanted to thank Cal Wells for spending some time with us. He's got to get to work because he's interested in observing Ricky Craven and Andy Houston. What are you looking for today in this practice?
Well, this is the last chance we've got to really figure things out based on these weather conditions for the 500. We're pretty excited about what we've learned so far. It's just another opportunity to hopefully bring them home in one piece and learn a little bit more about what we need for Sunday.
Quick pick in the Daytona 500? After your guys, of course.
Well, the guy who gets to the finish line third.
Okay, so Ricky Craven, Andy Houston, well, thank you, Cal.
Thank you
for spending some time. Have a good day. Enjoy the week. Let's go back upstairs for that practice with the Wisdom Kept Cars and Mike Joy.
Thanks, Chris. Cars on the speedway, and a group of them quickly got up to speed, figuring out how these cars will work in a draft. As many of these drivers, like we said, Daryl, they've got to race their way into the Daytona 500. They can't fall back on their speed or their owner points. They've got a lot of work to do today.
Well, they really do, and I keep saying this, and it's true, and Larry knows, there's so many people on different agendas. So many people are looking at different aspects of different things. That's the good thing about having teammates. You try the soft setup. I'm going to try the stiff setup. You put this gear in. You put that gear in. You run with this. You run with that make a car. I'm going to run with this make a car. And at the end of the day, you go debrief and tell the crew chief what you found out.
How did you do all that before there were multi-car teams?
Well, you had buddies in the garage then. You know, you just went over to someone, whoever you thought you could run good with. A lot of guys don't. There are particular drivers that you like to run with, that you know are predictable. That you know when they give you that's not too serious. If they give you one of those, that's real serious. Or if they give you one of these,
yeah, right. Yeah.
You know, you kind of know what to anticipate out of that driver, and that's the guy you want to run with.
Larry, are you setting up here for long runs? You just want to see how the car works in the draft? What?
Well, I mean, you're going after several things here. You need to see how it runs with other cars, you know, because cars handle different. Maybe around a Dodge, and it does a Pontiac, around a Ford, around a Chevrolet. But we talked about it yesterday. They're checking that fuel mileage. I talked to a lot of the crew chiefs in the garage area this morning. Again, the race on Thursday, the race is 50 laps with the new aero package, with all the things going on. They're borderline of being able to go that. So they're getting good fuel mileage checks. But the thing that concerns me a little bit for these guys is for 2 days of race practice, we've had cloudy conditions. We saw how slick this racetrack can get in the Bud Shootout when it's sunny. So they're doing all this practice in overcast conditions. It may be 80 degrees on Thursday, and that could be a curveball there.
I can assure you that when the sun's out, shining on this racetrack, it becomes a bear. It becomes an animal. A car that you're happy with today in these overcast conditions can absolutely be out of control if the sun's out and it's hot and sunny and it's slick.
There was one anomaly to yesterday's practice as we watched Ricky run. His teammate, Dale Jarrett, spent the whole practice session yesterday running all by his lonesome.
I talked to Todd Perrin about that because we all picked up on that. And with 3 days of race practice, and Todd's done this before, and they're pretty good at doing this, what they decided to do is put the car in race trim. Open up the front end like you know you're going to have to race it with the front end opens. And what they did, they just went out and made 5-lap runs by themselves. Robert had an intake manifold he wanted to try. Todd had some shocks. You know, he just wanted Dale's feedback, how it changed the driving, and watch the most important computer, and that's that stopwatch, if it run faster. And he said they picked up 2.5 tenths by doing that.
Okay, and let me just jump in real quick. The reason that he does that by itself is because you cannot analyze anything when you're in traffic. You can't give them good feedback when you got cars all around you, pushing you, buffing you, moving you around like you do. All by yourself, you can focus on the carburetor. You can focus on the shocks. You can focus on one thing.
And you can't figure out if it's faster or slower because you may go out there with one group of cars and you may run faster, another group you'll run slower.
Well, Daytona is hallowed ground to stock car racers and race fans. And right now in Victory Lane, the third wedding ceremony of the morning is being performed. How about that? Tomorrow is Valentine's Day, so these folks are getting a one-day jump. Congratulations to the happy couple. That's pretty neat.
Where's Hammond at? Why ain't he down there at the wedding ceremony?
Yeah.
He ought to be throwing the rice. I didn't get get married in Victory Circle, but on my honeymoon, I was racing a Sunday after I got married on Friday, which a lot of racers have done, I'm sure. I was trying to make enough money to get back home. Got married on Friday. I left town. I had a Visa card and $68 in my pocket. And when I got to where I was going, they took my Visa card because it was overdrawn.
Well, the fastest cars so far, Darrell, in this practice are Dodgers. Kyle Petty and Sterling Marlin have the two fastest practice times thus far, Matt.
Mike, Sunday afternoon, right after the Bud Shootout, NASCAR impounded the top finishing car from each make for a trip to the wind tunnel to compare aero numbers. Well, those cars will return this morning to the teams. Now, the rumors circling the garage area right now, because NASCAR hasn't officially released any numbers, which they usually don't, but word usually spreads pretty fast, that the Dodge was about 30 counts better than the bow tie or the Grand Prix with the blue badge mounts, finishing fourth overall. So you can imagine a lot of politicking will be going on for the rest of Speed Weeks, trying to get some numbers back from the Dodge.
Thanks, Matt. Look at practice times on the top, and look at this. Among the drivers, the 10 drivers who are racing, bringing Dodge back to Winston Cup. There's a lot of experience there on the top of that list.
But just look at this column over here, right here. No wins whatsoever. That means they've went out the experienced and the inexperienced. They got it covered on both areas.
Career starts among that group. Look at Bill Elliott, 623 career starts. That is more than seven of those drivers together. And there's Elliott, who will start on the pole for the third time in the Daytona 500 on Sunday.
Did you notice one of those Dodge guys, Jason Leffler?
Yeah.
This is it. This is number one.
That's
right. This is the first start.
He's hurting their average.
I'm correct. He won three in a row. This is Elliott's fourth pole for the 500.
Well, here we go, boys. You know, start off calm, but as you can see, action's picking up. Got three wide, one, two, three here. And that's about all this racetrack can handle safely. And that's, I should say, that's all it can handle on the borderline. Anything more than that, and you're way over the limit.
See Tony Stewart in the middle
one,
there.
One, two, three. That's what we talk about. We talk about three wide. I don't want to be here. You don't want to be in the middle line, because that's the car that's getting buffed around the most from air on both sides. So you don't want to be in the middle. If I'm going to be anywhere, I'm going to be down on this inside, because I got all those cars on the outside to bank off of if anything happens. Now, Richard Petty used to tell me that he liked to run up on the high side. We were talking about running the high line. I said, Richard, why you always run up there so high like that? He said, well, if I have any problem, I blow out a tire, I ain't gonna have the support to go to hit the wall. I said, yeah, but don't you hit the wall a lot?
I've heard him say that.
You see Mike Skinner's car, the blue car there in the middle, you talked about getting buffeted around. It was going to the inside, to the outside.
Yeah, he's not doing that on purpose. Or as my Sarah would say, he's not doing that by a purpose.
For those of you who are stuck home at 2 feet of snow, have those nice surround sound systems in your living room, give it a crank and you can listen to the sound of this pack here at Daytona.
And hectic out there on the racetrack. On the pit road, you got to few cars lined up there. There you see the NASCAR official. Now, the question would be, well, why aren't these guys out there practicing? Now, there'd be 43 cars out there on Sunday in the 500, about 26 cars in each race on Thursday. But NASCAR says, guys, let's play a little safe in practice. We're going to let about 20 or 25 at a time out there. And as one comes in, another one can go out.
Yeah, well, you got a 2.5-mile super speedway here. You got lots of room. But what does everybody want to do? They want to run in a pack. And if you had 43 cars out there, they'd all be running together. Something happens, you know, it might mess up our show come Sunday. So we're being a little conservative here.
All right, Winston Cup practice rolls on here at Daytona. We'll have more coverage of it for you tomorrow. We'll have the Twin 125 live on Fox Sports Net on Thursday. And we'll be right back to Daytona on Fox Sports Net after this word. Welcome back to Daytona. 5 days till the Daytona 500 on Fox. Bill Elliott and Stacy Compton will lead them down for the green flag. The whole rest of the field will be set live on Fox Sports Net this Thursday in the Gatorade 125. Everybody out there, a lot of two wide and three wide running, and now nice tight draft.
Well, what you really got to be careful of is we keep talking about three wide. Give you a real good shot of what. Well, we're going to look at drafting first. We're going to come down the back here. The lead car here, he's a sitting duck, particularly with this aero package. There's such a wake, as you can see, going around this car. That's air going around the cars. It goes way on back past that, even that third place car. So there's a vacuum there. This guy gets a slingshot out. This cat right here, number three, he's going to push the two car forward, and they're going to just fly by that first car, just like you put on the brakes.
Now, the one mistake I saw, the car in front making, I remember back to 98, not that he needed to hear it from me, but as we was leading the Daytona 500 coming in, it's like, Dale, watch your mirror. Don't let those guys get back and get a run on
you.
Because a lot of times, if those guys start backing up, you got to backpedal a little bit and go back with them. That way, they don't get that run on you. Jeff Hammond, I bet you've done the same thing.
Absolutely, Larry. You've got to help that driver sometimes, because he's out there, he's a sitting duck, like Daryl says. And if you spotter, you don't remind him what's going on, they'll go to sleep, and next thing you know, you're going to be real unhappy with the results. Sorry about that. Hey, one thing I've been noticing here, my teammates last year, the Roush guys, are starting to come to life. 97 cars picked up some speed in about 2 seconds faster than what he was being earlier. 99 car of Jeff Burton, he's up there in the number two place, as well as Mark. I mean, he looks a lot stronger than he's been being all week. So I think Jack has finally got driven into the guy's head. This is a long time at Daytona, and they're getting better as that comes down to the end.
Boy, that 0-1 of Jason Leffler, the car with the white hood and the red X on it. What a welcome to Winston Cup drafting. He got the last three or four laps there.
Well, the thing about it is if you don't have a fast car and you're trying to get up in there and you haven't quite got your speed up, buddy, you can cause a mess. That's about what he did. Now, here he is. He's trying to pass down on Dale Jr. Here's three wide. We keep talking about three wide. One, two, three. I want to explain that to you because we say that a lot. But look at this. This three wide with some help here. This is three wide with a buddy. And he's going to bump him and push him right by those other guys.
Kurt Busch in the 97 car, he's what we call the sitting duck.
Yes, sir.
And he's a rookie at that.
He's in the rocking chair.
Look how close these guys are getting. That's where it gets hairy, Daryl, is coming off the corner, because the cars are wanting to move up anyhow. When you're three wide off the corner, that's where it gets real hairy.
Watching Mark Martin, and with him the 7 of Mike Wallace. A lot of traffic here on the racetrack. Probably 30 or so cars are on the track right now. Steve Burns, how about in the garage?
Here's a rare opportunity, Mike. It's not that crowded back here, but we're going to take a rare opportunity to sneak inside the garage area, show you what the teams have to play with. You got sway bars, the ever-present computer, shocks down here, springs down here. Of course, all the tools a man could ever want. Now, Stacy Compton, right next door, has just pulled in. They're going to take a look at his Dodge, but just want to give you a little sneak peek at what goes on in here in the garage while the cars are on the racetrack.
Anything they don't have there is in the hauler.
Yeah, a lot of times you come in and what goes on in the garage is sitting there eating ice cream.
That's pretty good.
You're out there scared to death.
I mean, what amazes me about these toolbox, Daryl, 15, 20 years ago, we had the old toolbox that you'd unload out of the back of the truck. Two guys would sit it on the workbench. I told our guys a toolbox they built last year. I said, guys, if you get any bigger, we're going to have a fuel permit for it.
Well, I know. You got brakes on them now. Pretty soon they'll be motor driven. These things are so big. They got everything on them but a kitchen sink, and I think they're working on that.
There's Jerry Nadeau, number 25, right, ooh, in the middle of things. He and Todd Bodine exchanging Valentine greetings right there.
Well, it's kind of push and shove, you know. He pushed over into him, and it makes Nadeau's car, he has to react to the air off of Todd's car, and when the air releases, it releases the car, and he almost jumps right back into it. Sometimes, man, I'm telling you, you're sitting there hanging on that thing, wondering where it's going to go next. And I use the term wandering loosely, but that's what they look like they're doing.
Boy, look at the run. I believe that's Kenny Wallace in the 27 car with Todd Bodine in the 66 Pushman. They got that run up off the corner down low, and boy, he's shot by about three or four cars.
Working a lot on handling and also, Matt, fuel mileage.
Mike pulling several crew chiefs in the garage here this morning. The biggest concern besides missing the big wreck in the twin 125s is fuel mileage. Ken Schrader's crew chief, Sammy Johns, told me they ran out of gas 50 laps after they pitted in the Budweiser shootout on Sunday. I spoke with several other crew chiefs. They feel like they may have to stop or pit gas and go in the twin 125s because they factor in the pace laps. They cannot go the distance. One big reason, because this year NASCAR mandated a new gauge in the steel for the fuel cells. Teams are not able to blow them up to stretch out the cells to try to get more gas in them. Many crew chiefs tell me they're losing about 2.5 to 3 gallons. So that will definitely play a factor on Thursday. Jeannie?
Well, Matt, the three car worked so hard on the aero package, the tolerance is a little too close. That's why we saw Dale Earnhardt make his way into the garage. They were working on that fender in the left front tire there. It was rubbing a little bit. The other thing they're working on as well is fuel. As you just mentioned, Matt, they actually pumped some fuel out. What they're going to do now is try to see how far they can go on it. But he's on his way back in, so we'll check in with him and see what's going on.
Yeah, a lot of teams now realize that they'll go out there, they'll put 5 gallons of gas in the car. That's all they got in the tank. And they'll run that 5 gallon out so they can get a good reading on their gas mileage and be sure they can pick up every ounce of fuel in that fuel cell.
And with this plate, this motor combination, these things are getting about 5.75 miles to the gallon. That's a little over 2 laps to the gallon. And the thing I want to make sure everybody knows is these things hold 22 gallons of fuel. Now, NASCAR don't actually measure how many gallons you put in the cell, but they know what the dimensions of that fuel cell should be to hold 22 gallons. And what Matt was talking about is a little lenient in past. And sometimes these cells would hold as much as 22.5, 23. Darrell, I think he maybe had one held 25 or 6 gallons one time.
They were lenient in the past, as you said.
They held them to 22 gallons.
When you walked over there on Sunday morning and the trunk bed of your car is bowed up and you wonder why, and you look at that air hose stuck in the side of that fuel tank, you know why.
Here's a look at the top practice times so far. Cal Wells with reason to smile. His lead driver, Ricky Craven, tops the speed chart. Jeff Burton, Robert Presley, and then Derek Cope is up there. Winston Cup practice continues for the 125-mile qualifying races. You're watching NASCAR on Fox Sports Net. Welcome back to NASCAR on Fox Sports Net. NASCAR for your weekend, the Napa 300 on Fox at 12:30 Eastern next Saturday, followed by Happy Hour, final Winston Cup practice on our sister station FX. And then next Sunday, the 43rd Daytona 500, 11:30 a.m. Eastern Time. Our coverage begins on Fox.
Am I getting used to this, Mike, or is it just a little calmer today than it's been being?
For some reason, Darrell, this doesn't look as frantic to me as practice did yesterday with everybody three wide, running complete laps, three abreast.
Yeah, everybody seems to be content right now to just kind of, I think maybe everybody's working on specific things.
There's Lonesome Dale again.
Now, Todd Parrott told me they was going to work on running and packing. He's been out there again, and there you can see his fast lap. Well, they hadn't showed his fast lap, but he's out there just trying things, and he's the slowest car that's been out there at 49.86 compared to the fastest time by Mike Skinner at 47.55. So he's just out there doing the same thing he was doing yesterday.
Let me just point out that 49.86 would be a pretty darn good qualifying run all by yourself. So that's not a slow speed when you compare it to qualifying.
Right.
Especially especially with race openings. Where
right, but the grill's open and he's not on the qualifying run. So that's really quite good.
Let's show you the busiest cars in this session. Those that have run the most laps will drop down out of our Fox box in the upper left of your screen. Kyle Petty, Gary Nadeau, Kenny Schrader, Ricky Rudd, and Derek Culp put on the most laps in this practice session.
We heard Culp say he was going to try to run about 30, 40 laps.
There they are. Now, folks, we know that we have our most avid NASCAR fans watching these practice sessions. I want to pass along to you. We've seen a lot of comments have come through on the internet about this graphics package as it develops. Folks, you're going to get used to that ticker at the top of the screen. We have a lot of computer-enhanced animations and how those cars look. There's been a lot of comments in the papers. This is a work in progress. We're developing this. Please keep in mind, and I'm not apologizing here, we're all NASCAR veterans, but the Fox network is new to racing. Those networks that covered NASCAR had 20 years to refine their on-air look. We've had 4 days. We're going to get there. We appreciate your concerns. We're going to get there, and I promise you're going to like it. It's going to be enhanced information like you've never had before.
We're going to do it the Fox way.
Jeannie?
Well, I just told you that the number three car was going back out on the track trying to run out of gas, get it all out of the motor, and you're back already, so just one lap. You done for the day?
Yeah, we are. We ran the car out of gas to see how much our fuel cell would hold. It gives us an idea of the gas mileage for the race on Thursday. So, you know, Daryl's familiar with all that. That's basically what we did. We did that with a practice engine. Now we're going to put a race motor in. We'll do a little practicing tomorrow with a race motor to get a flow check. But, you know, Daryl, guys up there in the booth, we got it pretty good down here in the garage area. You see our guys down here.
Hey, Jeannie.
Also, we need a raise, too.
Jeannie, Larry
wants... This is my new agent, by the way. But yes, Larry, go ahead.
Tell him Larry wants to know how much fuel the fuel cell held.
Larry wants to know how much fuel the fuel cell holds. I guess you should give him the official line here first.
What do you want to know, Larry?
I want to know how much fuel you held there.
I can't hardly hear you.
How much fuel did your fuel cell hold?
I can't tell you, Larry.
Now, why can't you? We're supposed to be buddies.
If I told you,
to be buddies.
Then you would tell somebody else, and then you would tell NASCAR, they'd tell NASCAR, and then they'd be on me. Actually, with all the new NASCAR rules, just a little over 22. They kill us about a gallon and a half or better than what we were getting in it. So you know what we were getting. So about a gallon and a half is what they took away from us.
Are you listening to some of these rumors about the wind tunnel results that are circulating around and that maybe there's one car maker out here that has an advantage over others?
Well, that's what you're saying. And, you know, they were in practice. It looked sort of fishy that they didn't run that well until qualifying. And so they may be sandbagging until Sunday. So we have to wait until Sunday and see what happens. I don't think NASCAR is going to change anything this short notice. But, you know, that's good that they're looking. They want to analyze things and see how things look. And maybe they'll do it again after the 500 and give us a better idea of what's going on. But I was really surprised because the Ford and the Dodge's templates are so much closer than the same that I would have thought they'd have been closer together to where they were.
Thanks for the plug for the pay raise. I'll let you know how that goes. You have a great rest of the day.
I appreciate it. We're having more fun down in the garage area, guys, since y'all aren't here.
Matt?
Well, Jeannie, two of the Roush guys, Jeff Burton and Mark Martin, discussing things over. Mark, your car looked very good in practice yesterday. How optimistic are you about your package for the 2125s on Thursday?
Well, the car is really not fast enough, but it sure does handle good, and hopefully the racetrack will get slick and the tires will get worn, and you know, it did a little bit of that in the Bud Shootout, and we really were competitive in that race. Even though we're not really fast enough, if we can handle good, be in the right spot, do all the right stuff, we can get a good starting spot for the 500.
Have you been able to pull out and pass it all during this practice?
With a fast car behind me. We can sure do it, yes, but, you know, that's the real trick, is to get people to run with you, and that's the big advantage that Earnhardt has, is Earnhardt's car is not really, I don't think his car is any faster than mine, but, you know, people line up behind him because they know he's the master, and that's what makes him the master, is all those pushes that he gets, and we just have to hope that, you know, in the races that we can earn enough respect from folks that they'll hang with us, and if they do, well, you know, we can run real good with fast cars behind us.
Well, he'll start out as run 13th in the second twin 125 on Thursday, guys.
Well, Larry and Mike, I just want to explain something if I can. Aero numbers are very deceiving. A car with low drag numbers might qualify well, but it might be a handful to race because it doesn't have enough downforce. That said, a car with a lot of downforce, depending on if it's balanced, front to rear, can be a driver's best friend. So even though they say they've got a disadvantage in drag, and that may hurt them qualifying, I'm going to tell you, on those long runs Sunday, give me that race car.
And as for the wind tunnel, that will give you the whisper in the wind numbers that are floating around the garage. Again, nothing official has been reported, but the Dodge apparently was more efficient by itself in the wind tunnel. The Chevrolets and Pontiacs were pretty similar, and the Fords seemed to be a bit less efficient. Here are the drivers who have run the least in this practice session.
And qualifying's over. Yesterday we saw that, and we made the call that these guys are still in qualifying mode. What this tells me, these guys went out and run a few laps, maybe even twice, and said, come in and said, crew chief, man, this thing ain't driving right. You're going to have to do something to
That's
it.
That's right.
You know, in aero, there's no free lunches. And I think you hit the nail on the head, Darrell. If you reduce the drag, if you make the car slippier, you hurt the downforce. If you increase the downforce, make the car drive better, you hurt the drag. There's just no free lunches. If you help one, you hurt the other.
They are four abreast here in the back straightaway.
Yeah, they are. I mean, we've been talking three.
Gosh. We sorted that out, thank goodness.
I don't stay that way long, but long enough to get me excited.
There's pole sitter Bill Elliott right in the thick of it. And there's the last man to win the Daytona 500 in a Dodge, Richard Petty.
Great.
Winston Cup practice continues right after this on Fox Sports Net. High atop the Winston Tower, these are the eyes of the Winston Cup drivers, the spotters at work. 5 days. They'll be spotting the Daytona 500 on Fox.
See this guy right here? That's David Smith. He's the team manager for Mike Skinner, but he was the jack man for all those years. They was called the Flying Aces, Earnhardt's pit crew, when he won all those championships, Darrell.
Yeah, he's moved on into an executive position now. That jack got a little hard to swing over the wall.
Now, Robert Yates is having a word there. Mike Beam, Ricky Craven.
I can't imagine what they're talking about.
He puts the engines in that car.
Body on that car. I mean, it's a good drag. I can hear it up in the hall.
You see, Robert Yates, of course, builds Robert Yates Engine Company, builds the motors for this race team. That's Mike Beam there on the left, and he's the crew chief. And, you know, it just sounds like they're talking about cars pulling back up, not pulling back up.
Well, here's what's happening. Robert Yates, the engine builder. These other boys are car builders. Now, these boys on the left here, Mike Beam and these guys over here, they're telling Robert that the motor won't run. They just won't pull up. And Robert said, boys, I'm telling you, you got too much drag in your car. Your car is what the problem is. And so Robert walks off and just leaves him scratching their head.
Well, if I were Ricky, I wouldn't have that long face right now. He's the second fastest practice speed. Jeannie?
All right, we're watching this meeting. The world is watching this meeting on Fox. So I have to ask you, first and foremost, what was going on? It's just us talking here.
You gotta pay the price to get in on that conversation. But things are really going well for us. And, you know, we made some big, big changes from yesterday. And my gosh, a car responded. Robert come down. Right now, we're kind of splitting hairs. Now, that doesn't mean that it won't go away tomorrow. But we really hit on something today. And hopefully, we're in good shape for Thursday.
Well, not to take away from your performance today, but there is some talk around the garage here that, hey, you know, one car maker in particular, one that you are close with, had some problems in the wind tunnel testing, and NASCAR is aware of it now, and maybe they're cutting you some slack today. So I'm giving you the opportunity to speak up. Did they come to you today? Did they let you make any changes?
Absolutely not. But there's going to be a lot of that discussion, because I think it began last Saturday when Bill came out of nowhere, and they obviously put a good effort together during the winter, but Bill surprised everybody with that. And that was a great effort, but I think a little bit of cat and mouse this week. Everybody's still suspecting that maybe the Dodgers are the car to beat. I can think of a couple Fords that are running pretty fast. And our objective is just to focus on the little things, the details, because we truly have a shot to run well.
I'll tell you what it all means, though. It means for a great Daytona 500. Steve?
Jeannie, we're with Ward Burton. Ward, tell the viewers at home, what are you guys trying to accomplish today with this race team, this Dodge?
Well, you know, yesterday's actually our first information gathering day when we were in a race atmosphere, even though we're not racing with practicing with our competition. So we got a lot of information yesterday. We're actually starting like our information book, you know, where we had 3 years with the Pontiac or more with the new Pontiac. Now we got a whole new deal with the Dodge. So everything we're doing, we're making sure we keep careful notes on it. Today is another one of those information gathering days.
Making progress?
Oh, yeah, man, I'm pretty happy with it, I tell you what. My team has worked so hard. You know, even we were running the 2000 campaign last year. They worked for 9 months on this race car, and the race cars we're getting ready to bring out next couple of weeks. And, they sacrificed a lot, their family sacrificed a lot, and we got a good piece here this weekend because of their hard work.
Thank you, Ward.
You know, guys, one of the things I always told Jeff and all the crew chiefs I've had, I don't want to hear about what everybody else is doing. I don't want to hear about how good somebody else is. You work on your race car. You work on what we got. Quit comparing us to everybody else. And when we got ours as good as we can get it, then we'll worry about everybody else. But we got work to do. Don't tell me what somebody else is doing.
You got to work to be the best in class. Jeff Ford, you got to work to be the best Ford. And Robert Yates taught me this. You know, I've been caught up in these manufacturers. He got, they got. But you focus on your car. Let the owners, NASCAR, sort out what we need, what we don't need. And when you do that, you might be surprised just how good you perform.
And not only that, Larry, but you know, as a driver, I talk to other drivers. Other drivers says, well, hey, I got a, you know, I'm running a 600-pound frame on a bump rope. You are? How are you doing that? So I run into Larry, Dale's over there running his car on a 600-pound spring on the bump rubber. And you look at me like, so? I mean, you go out and you hear what everybody else is doing, and you want to know why you're not doing it. And really, all you do is confuse everybody.
And I've never had a problem telling a guy what four springs was under my race car, because there's 100 different elements that goes with those four
springs.
Oh, yeah,
what's the rest of the story?
Let's point out that NASCAR Winston Cup director Gary Nelson very closely watching this practice, and he has been black flagging any driver who dips a wheel down on the apron. And so far, that has included Morgan Shepherd, Norm Benning, Kurt Busch, and the next man to see that black flag will be Steve Park.
Well, you know something? Now, you're going to laugh when I tell you this, but we had our little meeting at Talladega, and I asked the question, why do we not have out-of-bounds stakes? Why do we not have out-of-bounds parking? Why don't we have a penalty for going out-of-bounds? We have it in every other sport. And everybody kind of laughed. But I tell you, that stopped some of that getting so bottled up down at the end of the back straightaway there. It would stop people from getting run off into grass going up the back straightaway. I think at some point in time, they're going to have to initiate some sort of rule like that.
And the apron is considered anything below that yellow line.
Yeah, this line down here, I'll get to it in a minute. That line down there, anything below that, that's the apron. And you don't need to be getting down there, because there's no place for you to go when you come back on the racetrack. And through this trial, the same way. I mean, you get down in here, yeah, you can get down there, the car will stick. But when you come back onto the racetrack, where it causes the problem.
Darrell, just calm down, buddy. Everything's okay. Stay focused on what's going on. We got everything under control here. Larry, you got to get
going
quicker now.
I'm telling you,
I'm seeing it coming again. You got to calm down, buddy. Remember, it's a long race here at Daytona. Everything's going to be all right. NASCAR's going to take care of it.
I told you if they'd just do something like that, it'd be a lot better. What did I tell you?
Believe what I'm trying to tell you. I hear you, partner. I hear you.
I'm starting to believe Earnhardt. It may be a lot more fun down there.
There's our man, Dale Jarrett. He's out there still running by himself. I got to go talk to Todd this afternoon. Said, are you ever going to get out there and run with the pack?
He's pedaling hard. He's doing what I like to do all by myself.
Lonesome George. We'll be back to Daytona International Speedway in a minute. You are watching Winston Cup practice on Fox Sports Net. Welcome back to Winston Cup practice for the Gatorade 125s that you'll see live here on Fox Sports Net this coming Thursday afternoon. As you all know, Fox is new to NASCAR. And for folks like Darrell, Larry, and me that have been coming down here 20 years or more, it's really hard to convey the feeling to the people who are new to Daytona of just what it means to us to come to Daytona and see this unfold. And what a special time of the season and of the year and in the sport this is. It's a little hard even for us to explain sometimes, so we ask some of the drivers to lend a hand.
It just starts from the time you go through the tunnel or through the gate. The hair stands up on your arm, and to see the size of the racetrack itself and the cars, and there's just so much that goes into it. And I think it's coming from a racing family, it's a dream to be able to compete in the Daytona 500.
Probably one of the best known racetracks in the world. Remembering the first time I made a lap around the racetrack, tears came to my eyes. It was a dream come true.
It's our biggest event. We spent all winter long preparing for that race, and it's just a huge, huge event. And when you do win it, you realize that there's nothing greater that you can accomplish, you know, in this sport than the Daytona 500.
When I come to Daytona, I know that I'm competing against everybody when they're at their best. Everybody has more time to prepare for this race than any other one we're going to run all year long. There's more effort, there's more emotion. This is absolutely what you live for, is your moment in the sun, because the sun is shining here when it isn't shining anywhere else.
How'd you feel your first time here, Larry?
Well, you know, it's an awe. It's like going to a monument. But to me, the one time every year, year one and year 20 last year, that makes the hair stand up on the back of my neck, and until you've experienced it, you can't describe it, is standing in them pits, those 43 cars take that green flag, they come around lap one, and the ground's rumbling. You know, the ground's rumbling under your feet. It like just, I'm getting goosebumps talking about it again.
How about you, Jeff?
Mike, all I can say, Mike, the first time, any time I've been at Daytona, if you can't get what Larry's talking about, the goosebumps, and I'm getting them right now again, when you watch these guys put on the show they're putting on, and they come down that short chute right where they're headed right now, it just gives you, I mean, I think it'd be like getting in a ride with going to the moon or something, because it just really gets the adrenaline flowing, your mouth gets dry, and you just get so excited about all the energy that's going through you. And I think it's coming from all the fans and all the drivers, but it just gets so exhilarating, just hard to describe. Man, I wish there was some way you could make every fan out there understand how good it feels to be a part of it.
Ken Squire?
Well, I got to tell you, when you come down here at this time of the year, I can remember 1965 going into a little bar just off Main Street, and somebody said, over there, right over there in the corner, those three guys, that's Freddie Lorenzen. Oh, my heart. Fearless Freddie Lorenzen was right there in the same bar that I'm sitting in. It was amazing. I mean, it was electric. So it's not only on the track, it's off the track. It's everywhere. It's everything that's involved in Daytona at this time of year. This is the time of year, right now, today, when everybody comes to town, the fraternity gathers. The Reverend Hal Marchman used to call it the Redneck High Holy Days. Well, now it's a lot more than that. It's all the people, all the promoters, every grifter, every pool hall hustler who's got an idea about how you can go one squinch faster. They're all down here selling those ideas. Some are legal, some are illegal. All of it's happening at once, and all the promoters are down here. They're all trying to make deals. They want to get Dale Earnhardt to their track. They want to get Bobby Labonte. We'll pay you $7,000. All you have to do is come in and sign a few autographs and wave to the crowd. The deals are going on over here behind us in the garage, and that will continue all week. There's no other racing in America but Daytona in the month of February. Speed Weeks is part of the history, and it's exciting, it's exhilarating. It makes you young all over again every time you come down here for the great American race.
And that's Ken Squire, who's been here for 36 years. Let's get a word from the rookie stripe member of our crew, Jeannie Zelasco's here at her first 500. What do you think, Jeannie?
Well, interestingly enough, I'm just coming off the other Super Bowl, you know, the one the NFL plays, and I have landed here on Wednesday, drove by the track on Wednesday night, and you look across and it's empty and it's humongous, but you don't get the feeling till you show up the next day, till the drivers are here and the cars are pulling in and you see the crew. What is so incredible to me, though, and as NASCAR fans know this, but seeing it firsthand, as huge as this event is, the fans are right here in the garage, and how gracious the drivers are, and they have a lot of work ahead of them, and this is their Super Bowl, and they're very gracious and very approachable, and it's just a wonderful event. It feels like a family, to be real honest with you, like a family event.
The the first time I was here for this event. They fired off the engines and my eyes just filled up with tears because I couldn't believe this was what I'd worked for my whole career, to be here and be a part of this in February. And I guarantee you Sunday they'll fill up again, you know, like they always do. Just the, it's overwhelming emotion of what it means to be a part of the Daytona 500. And that's on the minds of everyone in that garage and certainly every driver on that track, to make the race, to be a part of the Daytona 500. Hey, look who's out there in the draft. Old Lonesome George, number 88, Dale Jarrett, has finally decided to put that Robert Yates horsepower to the test and see if he can pass in the draft. We'll check on him when we come back. You're watching Winston Cup practice on Fox Sports Net.
Want heart-pounding highlights? Then you've got to see this. It's death-defying car.
Welcome back to Winston Cup practice at Daytona. More practice on Fox Sports Net tomorrow. And then, the Gatorade 125s on Thursday at noon. First ever live telecast to see how we set the field for the Daytona 500. When we left you, Dale Jarrett had been running on the track by himself. The pack caught him and put him in the middle of that draft, so he pitted.
But he drove to the front of the pack before he pitted. So
he's just verifying everything they were doing was working.
All right, let's meet the man who has the fastest time on the chart in this afternoon's practice. Here's Steve.
With Mike Skinner. Mike, you got that Chevrolet working good. Now, working on the cars, but you told me you're working on your attitude this year.
Yeah, just, you know, the race car is doing real, real good. You know, it's the speed chart doesn't mean a whole lot. You just got to get in the right air and the right draft, and you can put a fast lap up on the board. But, you know, I was showing you my new helmet. This is my good buddy Tex did this helmet. What an awesome job. The guy's got an attitude right there for sure. But we're having a lot of fun.
All right, best of luck in the 500, Mike.
All right.
Mike Skinner, 47.557, the quickest, about a 1,500th off of that, is Ricky Craven. And there's about $45,000 being picked up on the hook.
And when you talk about engines at Daytona Speed Weeks, teams will bring 10 or 12 motors down here. They'll bring qualifying motors. They'll bring practice motor, which I'm sure just come out of Earnhardt's car. Then they'll actually have the race motor. Now, the difference in them, for the most part, they're all the same components. They're the same cubic inches they have to be. But qualifying motors will have lighter parts. The less rotating weight you can have, the faster those motors will run, the more power they'll make. Now, a lot of teams will put their qualifiers back in the bar for the 125s. The teams that only can really afford to take that chance and do that is teams that safely in the 500. Teams that have to race their way in, they got to go more with a race combination, which is just a little more conservative package.
Which is unfortunate because the guys that need the qualifying motors can't take a chance on running.
I'm told that on a qualifying engine crankshaft, instead of those big beefy bearings that you find at the parts counter at your Chevrolet dealer, that they have thinned down the journals on the crankshaft to where they're running little bearings no bigger than you'd find on a Honda Accord to reduce drag.
Well, and this was the big thing that went on last year, especially with the Penske engines. And there was this big deal back at Sonoma in June where they tore the engine apart right out in front of everybody. And I think, you know, NASCAR's very careful before they make rules. They make sure how much it affects people, what the cost is going to be. But I think they got concerned how much money was being spent on qualifying motors, so they wanted to look at what was going on there.
Well, in the 21st century, there's an incredible amount of technology. And if you stay with the same rule package over a period of time, these mechanics, these owners, the engineers, the manufacturers will all figure out how to maximize every ounce of power you can get out of an engine with restricted play.
So the rules have to evolve as the technology evolves.
That's right, or else they'll just go back out of sight again. We'll be up to 210 mile an hour again.
Winston Cup practice continues. Mike Skinner, Ricky Craven, and Robert Presley are now the three fastest drivers. We'll be right back.
After an illustrious
outside pole sitter for the Daytona 500, Stacy Compton in the Mark Melling Dodge comes in after a practice run. And a quick check of things as this practice session winds down. There's the red and black flags in the air and on the upper left of your screen on the Fox box. That little green jet. yellow will turn to red to indicate this practice session has ended. And there's the speed chart right up there. Mike Skinner, Ricky Craven, Robert Presley, Jeff Burton, Derek Cope. A few surprises in that top five.
There really is. And it doesn't mean a whole lot. It just means that you can run if you get in the right group of cars.
All right. Our president, David Hill, says we got to explain why it don't mean why you're running fast. And again, Mike Skinner alluded to it. We're here at Daytona, and everywhere else we go besides here in Talladega, how fast you run is important. Don't get me wrong, speed's what racing is all about. But when you're in race trim and you're in drafting, if you're lined up in a row and you're catching another pack, you're going to run the speed up. And the reason I say it's not that important, Darrell, you got Dale Jarrett that's 39th. You got Dale Earnhardt that's 43rd fastest. Do you think Dale Earnhardt's car would be sitting in the garage if he was not better than a 43rd place car?
That most of this stuff that we're looking at on this screen right here, these times, that's just for us. It makes good television.
And it sounds good if you're
189 mile an hour. He's the fastest car here. Kiss my grits.
Further look back through the speed chart. All 52 Daytona 500 entries were on the speedway. As you look back. Yeah, all these meaningless times our producer Neil Goldberg adds in. Yeah. They're not meaningless, but
no,
they're for reference. They're reference times. We'll be back with lots more from Daytona. There's Dale Jarrett set to climb out, and the crews go to work. And so will we. We'll be right back here on Fox Sports Net. Robert Yates' crew working on Dale Jarrett's car 5 days till the biggest race of the year, and you'll see it on Fox, the Daytona 500.
Six down, five to go.
That's right.
Things are picking up. Tension's getting a little high in the garage. I hear a lot of things happening down there.
The Twin 125. Live for the first time, you will see it right here on Fox Sportsnet. There's a lineup for race one. And we figure that right about Casey Atwood's speed, 25th fastest overall, is where they're safe. And from there down, some of those drivers have provisionals. A lot of them don't. And some of them have, like Brett Bodine, had a fast speed in the second round. Now, usually one of these races is a wreck fest, and the second one is pretty clean. Any clue from the lineups which would be which?
Normally the first one is. And what happens is you stand on top of the truck, watch the first one, they beat and bang, wreck each other all up. And then the second one's a little calmer because you've seen
what could happen.
Carnage, and you don't want to be a part of it.
What I saw, both races have fast race cars, but when you look at that first race, there's some serious experience in that. I mean, you got Earnhardt, you got Labonte, you got Bobby Labonte, you got Dale Jarrett, you got Bill Elliott, of course.
And you've got it right here on Fox Sportsnet live Thursday at noon. More Cup practice tomorrow. We'll be right back to Daytona here on Fox Sportsnet.
Welcome back. We're live at Daytona, Fox Sports Net, as the Winston Cup practice wrapping up, and you see the brain trust of Robert Yates Motors there, Ricky Rudd, Dale Jarrett, Jeff Hammond. What's going on?
That right, John, is a perfect example of what teammates are doing, working together. Jarrett's been running by himself all day. Ricky's been in the middle of the pack. They're sharing information. Together, they're going to put together a game plan that may be hard to handle for the competitors.
Yeah, Ford is back, and if you want horsepower, you want Robert Yates. Let's get out of the garage and pit area. Start off with Steve Burns. Steve?
Thanks, Chris. Stacy Compton, been a big surprise. Your thoughts as we get closer to Thursday in the 125?
Getting better all the time. As Kodiak Mellon Dodge, we finally found something today that helped us in drafting and drafted up towards the front and the middle and the back and back to the front. So pretty happy right now.
All right, let's go to Matt.
And Steve, much of the final practice session, Dale Earnhardt and his crew spent the session working on fuel mileage, but now they've got their big hoss in there, though, Twin 125 motor. That session, the final practice tomorrow before the Twin 125s, which usually the white knuckle, hold your breath type affair, as everyone hangs it out to see what they actually have for the 125s. Jeannie?
Matt, a little I told you so from the 88 car. Now that the wind tunnel tests are coming public, Dale Jarrett says, see, I told you my car maker is at a disadvantage. So all day long, he spent time trying to improve the speed of his car. And here's what we have to look forward to tomorrow. He will actually partake in the draft. Stay tuned. Chris?
All right, thanks, Jeannie. All right, Twin 125 on Thursday, Ked Squire, an exciting front row there in the first race with Elliott and Jarrett, and Ford gave us the signal that we'll be on the lookout for.
Oh, yeah, you said it. The Fords are back. It's like a Saturday matinee Western. You've got Craven, Presley, Jeff Burton, second and third and fourth quickest, but hiding in ambush, ready to come out. There's Wallace and Mayfield, and here comes Jarrett and Rudd. I tell you, we're in for a show on Thursday and for sure on Sunday in the 500.
All right, and Jeff, you're in this race. You'll be looking for that drafting partner that you know and love and trying to learn from that for the Daytona 500.
Absolutely, Chris. What I saw in practice today was a situation where a lot of the guys that were in the first race ran together and a lot of guys that were in the second race tried to run together. That's the best way to find out how good your car really is and who you might be able to work with during one of these 125s to get into the Daytona 500.
And check out Totally NASCAR, 6 o'clock Eastern, Monday through Friday on Fox Sports Net. Steve Burns, your host, will be coming to you, of course, from Daytona all week. Winston Cup practice again tomorrow. We get you ready for the Twin 125. Mike Skinner, the fastest time today, speed of just over 189 miles per hour. For all of us here at Fox Sports Net, thanks for watching. I'm Chris Myers from Daytona. We'll see you throughout the week. Take care.